Hello, everybody, and this is Stacey from The Advisor. And today I'm very, very excited because we have a very special guest. Her name is Kayla Myers, and she is an amazing psychotherapist. And she's here today to tap onto some amazing topics in mental health. And we're going to talk a little and breeze about on a couple of different topics, but she really is focused on mental health and ways to improve your life overall by improving your mental health. So, Kayla, tell everybody a little about yourself and what you do. I'd love to hear more about you.
Of course. Thank you for having me. I'm really enjoying the space, Stacey, and I'm really excited to be here. So as Stacey said, I'm Kayla. I'm a licensed clinical social worker, a licensed psychotherapist, and my practice, Focus Health, specializes in working with people who've experienced trauma. And there's 11 different domains of trauma. And so we can think of people who've experienced natural weather, racial-based trauma. So I personally work with people who've experienced adverse childhood experiences, which is going to be more in the space of chronic trauma, because we know when we were little humans, we can't leave those environments. And so whenever we grow up, that kind of leaves us with lots of narratives that we learned about ourselves. And so I work with folks who have experienced that, and also work with folks who have been assaulted. So those are my two domains of trauma. So work with about 25 people a week, and that's what we process and explore in their personal lives and their professional lives, wherever these things are showing up and making an impact. And in order to treat trauma, I'm certified in ketamine-assisted psychotherapy and brain spotting.
So can you tell us a little bit more about those two? For brain spotting, for people who don't know what it is, can you go more in depth about it?
Absolutely. So brain spotting is a theory that's really closely aligned with EMDR. EMDR is a little bit more, a lot of people know that one. So the biggest difference is EMDR is as a sensation, the rapid eye movement is going to go really fast back and forth. And brain spotting is going to be one central spot. And the reason that we use either of these theories, and there's amazing clinicians who do both, I chose brain spotting because I think it's a little bit more gentler as I was learning about both of them. The reason we're going to use them is because there's a bunch of scientific evidence that our trauma is stored in our mammalian brain, not necessarily our frontal cortex. So every day, no matter what we experience, we kind of wake up and we meet our daily needs. We breathe, we blink, we eat, we do all the things that we have to do. Because we know that trauma is stored in the mammalian brain. And so brain spotting allows us to access those memories. And then whenever we're processing them, we're doing less from a third point of view. Sometimes when we have really big traumas, we'll tell it as though it was someone else's experience instead of our own. So brain spotting, EMDR, really fantastic modalities to exist in our own feelings in the moment. And then we can actually process the trauma instead of disassociating from it, or this belief that, and a lot of times that's like a subconscious response, that that happened but didn't happen to me.
Right. That's true. So when the person does brain spotting, is that a one-on-one talking basis, or like what's the process, you know?
Yeah, fantastic question. So brain spotting, we would get to know each other a little bit. I think if you've ever experienced therapy before, doing a really good intake session is helpful. It builds the trust between you and who your therapist is. And it also lets them know what would we want to brain spot on. And sometimes that's a moment in time. And sometimes that's a belief system that we have about ourselves. So if we remember our trauma, which some people have a hard time with the memory of it, like they know something happened, but it's hard to really have all the details. Brain spot on the memory. If we don't have that, but we just have this belief of I'm broken or I can't accomplish that, and we just stuck in whatever that is, then we can brain spot that belief. There's much less rules in the statement or what we pick. Right. But you come into therapy, we'd start the session on kind of what we're doing today. And then your clinician or myself would pull out a brain spot, which is typically just like a, you remember those things from school, like the little pointers that you're taking on the chalkboard? That's literally what it looks like. I wish I had one today. And so they pull that out, and then we track based on your activation. We use activation because sometimes we feel lots of things at once. We can feel anxious and sad and overwhelmed. And so a clinician who practices brain spotting will check in with you based on our memory or our topic and say, how activated are we feeling at this spot? It's really a collaborative. And then you're spending the session existing, like your eyes are at that spot. We're processing whatever comes up for you. And some people do that internally, and then they kind of take a few minutes and look at the spot and just exist with their feelings. And some people share and explore as they're in session. And then that's what the session would typically look like based on the level of activation. There's lots of coping and supports your therapist can give you if that was a really traumatic experience. But that's kind of the overview. And I've had some really great results from the patients that I've been able to work with using the modality.
So you can actually tell the level of that you're feeling, like the by how the person is feeling. So that's how you determine what, you know, what really is, you know, really affecting that person's life by going through that specific time in their life and talking about it, and then, you know, then explaining the feelings that are behind it, and then seeing which feelings are being more activated and more, and you are more stronger than the other feelings that you're discussing in that conversation that you're having.
That was a great summary. Yeah. We kind of start at what is the memory or what's the belief system, and then where did that come from? Who taught us that? Whose voice is that? When did we absorb that? Or if it's a memory in time, what was going on from your point of view? A lot of times with trauma, we have a hard time embodying it or acknowledging that that was us in that story.
Yeah.
We get kind of passive with these events, almost like we're telling someone else's life, or we're recapping a really dramatic TV show or something. And that's right. Coping skill. But it shows up and it doesn't help us in other spaces, because whenever we from feeling feelings, our brain doesn't say like, okay, we're going to not feel the bad feelings. It's kind of like if you exist disassociated, then you're not going to be able to feel anything. And I think it shows up for people, which is one of the biggest reasons I think people start therapy. They want to feel more connected. They want to feel the good. It's just therapy isn't always fun. So we start with the reasons why we can't.
Right. And then is that when you get into the coping mechanism, where you've figured out what feelings are really holding you back or keeping you stuck or making you feel the way you do? And then you exemplify different coping mechanisms to try to help the person so they could overcome those feelings and move forward in their lives.
Absolutely. Yeah. So if we're having a really hard time in people pleasing. So maybe like 2 hours later, we're like, oh, I should have said this, or I wish I had stood up for myself here, or actually really didn't want to go to that party. And then we sit in therapy and we're like, oh, well, growing up, you weren't allowed to say no. You weren't allowed to use your voice. You were taught that, and that was reinforced. And if you did, there was a punishment.
Right.
And so you learn this combination of fawning and freezing. And so we don't get to just grow up and be like, oh yeah, I have a voice. Like that's not how it works. And so the coping skills, so we would explore that in using brain spotting or ketamine assisted psychotherapy. Where were the moments that you really wanted to say something as a kid and you weren't allowed? And how did it feel to be silenced that way? And we give that kind of inner child you a space to exist and to matter. Then we start making at the same time these small moments in real life. And so we don't respond to a text message right away. Our coping is going to be, let's take 15 minutes. Let's check in with all of ourselves. Do we really want to do that thing?
Yes.
And then interacting with other people as well. It's almost like they happen at the same time in whatever it is, whether it's memory or feeling. We process and we cope, because life doesn't stop outside of therapy.
Yeah. It's very true. It's like, it's almost like you have the things you learn in therapy, you really have to apply to your daily life on an ongoing basis and kind of make it part of your life. So when those things do pop up in life or something similar, you could actually use the coping mechanisms that you learn with your, you know, therapist or your psychotherapist. And then it kind of gets you through all the, you know, different types of, you know, obstacles that come your way in life.
Absolutely. Yeah. And that's why I really respect all my clients each week that show up, because it's hard. It's hard to exist in a space where, and therapy is also weird. Like, you know nothing about me besides what's my background.
Exactly.
And the cues and like my demeanor. So you get to see who I am based on how I act. But this is a space where it's just about you.
Right.
And we like go deeper and go deeper in these origins. And so therapy is hard and it's weird. And I really respect my clients and set no expectations for when they begin to trust me and how that process works for them. Cause we all have our own pathway to those things. Right.
That's very true. That's so true. You know, and it's like, I think, you know, when you're going through therapy, you know, it's a painful process too. Because it's like you have to really accept, you know, a lot of these things into your life. Like you know, like things go on, but I think a lot of times we're in denial sometimes. We don't want to have to face the fact of really the truth is in front of us. You know, we know, you know, deep down, I think subconsciously the truth, but I think, you know, really accepting it and then coming to face with it, I think is really hard. I think, you know, it's a painful situation. But once you get over the hump, and you're able to face all those emotions and all those things that are going on in your life that are causing you all these problems, it's like, you know, a whole new life for you. You know, you've really conquered all those issues in your life that have caused you so much pain and anguish throughout your life, you know, and now you faced it and you learned coping mechanisms to get through it. And now you could actually have a whole healthy, productive life, you know, something that you may never had your entire life, you know, and that's really special.
It really is. Yeah. But like you said, it's a lot of work because as you're sitting in therapy, it brings up so much more, because if you accept that these things happen to you, well, then you're left with the whys, and then you're left with, well, what do I do with that relationship now? Is that, what level of access does that person get now?
Yeah.
And that person could be completely different now than whenever you were a kid. And so it creates a lot of internal stability. And then we get to a place of like, we can start questioning and setting boundaries and existing in the reality.
Yeah.
But I think there's a big sigh of relief when my clients began believing themselves that like that did happen. Cause then there's not this like internal conflict.
Yeah. That's wonderful. I love it. I love it. Now you also do a therapy called ketamine therapy. And I know that's really popular, and it's, you know, a lot of people are, you know, really, you know, asking about it, and they're, you know, they're really, really curious about the therapy. Maybe you can go into it and explain it to people, because there's different ways that clinicians and doctors and psychotherapists, you know, do it compared to like, you know, ketamine clinics and, you know, so maybe you can explain what it is and then the difference between the two, like, you know, doing it in an office like yours versus doing it in a clinic and so forth.
I would love to. Yeah. So I currently treat individuals using ketamine. I treat relationships, siblings. Siblings has been a lot of fun and pretty new. And I offer ketamine retreats. And so it's a big part of, this is a timer light. Sorry, y'all. it's a big part of my practice, and I really believe in it as a modality. In the big asterisks and caveat, work with a good clinician, work with a good prescriber. I think there's a lot of excitement around ketamine and its ability to be helpful as the only like federally legal psychedelic right now. Psilocybin legal in a few states, and then MDMA being officially and finally voted on in August of this year. And so there's a lot going on in psychedelic medicines. And I think the medicine works. And so if you go to a clinic, you're going to have an experience, you're going to have a journey. But I think there's some education in the space of what does it look like and feel like. You go to a ketamine clinic, it's a bit more clinical than coming into a therapeutic office. So if you come to the office, it's warm and it's gray and it's yellow and there's music and there's a whole kind of structure. If you do IV infusions or you just go to your psychiatrist who's not also a therapist, some psychiatrists will practice talk therapy, you're going to get a different experience. It's going to feel a little bit like you're at the dentist or you are getting like some sort of spa treatment done, and you're left to your devices. You're like, you're kind of like someone will check in with you, but then it's just you. And so there's some pluses and minuses. Some people have good experiences there. I would say my preference being a therapist is, and if anyone ever asks me, I recommend ketamine assisted psychotherapy or CAP. Mm-hmm. And doing that, it's broken into three big parts. You have your prep. So what's going on here? What are the feelings? What are the memories? Almost a little bit similar to brain spotting. Because you came to therapy for a reason. Like if you're in my office, you came here with a sense and a purpose of what you want to be different. And so preparation, we explore that. And we do lots of consent conversations whenever we're thinking about existing in a journey or being on medicine with a therapist. It's important that we have informed consent. So a deep understanding of what can happen, what's actually going to happen, and then what that may feel like in the moment. And so there's a few kind of consenting to making sure this is what you really want. Right. And we're planning for your integration and all of those things. And then I do a collaborative care model, which means I have a personal relationship with my prescriber. So I'm a therapist, not a doctor. So a doctor does have to prescribe the medicine. And I personally work with Dr. Jessica Shepherd. She's amazing. And we have a great working relationship, which I think makes it better for the patients. Like they may not see it, but they know it. Cause I'm like, how'd your appointment with Dr. Shepherd go? And Dr. Shepherd would be like, how are things with Kayla going? So you have this kind of this team and it feels like a team. We both really care.
Right.
And that's a little bit different than a clinic. You could have a really great prescriber. They may refer you to a fantastic therapist. That doesn't mean they have a relationship. So if you're interested in ketamine, ask the therapist that, like, what's your relationship like with the doctor? Because then you're going to know that they can advocate for you if you need it. Because there's been times where someone would be nervous about, so we offer oral medicine and then IM, like a shot. And there's been times someone really doesn't want a shot. And I can just go to Dr. Shepherd and be like, hey, they don't want IM. And she's like, okay, well, this is what it would look like if we did oral medicine. And then we kind of have that conversation and she does all the education with the patient, but having that collaborative approach, I think really matters. So we do all that in prep. You meet with Dr. Shepherd, you meet with me, all that good stuff. And then you have your dosing, which I think this is the space everyone's most excited about. And you lay down, you spend time with your therapist, you take the medicine, you receive it. And then we cover our eyes. Because I work with trauma, covering your eyes is optional. Sometimes that's a comfort and sometimes it is not. It's really scary. Either way, we're going to listen to music and you're going to enjoy your journey. And then we typically, at least my patients, they end up talking while they're in that space. And so what's coming up for them based on the intentions that we set during prep, or what's our inner healing intelligence just kind of bringing up for us, and what do we need to continue processing? And then within a day or two, we have a session called integration. So like you said, everything we learn in therapy has to show up in real life. We can't exist inside of this like therapy bubble. And so we have integration, and then we begin integrating that into life. So this was our journey. This is what you explored for yourself or taught for yourself. We process it. And then what does that mean for us? And where is that going to show up outside of this safe therapy bubble?
Now, how does exactly like, you know, psychedelics work? So when you take the medication, you know, what then happens? Like what in your brain, you know, turns on or turns off? How does psychedelics actually help in the process of healing your mental health? Can you like go a little deeper and explain that to people? Because some people might not understand exactly what goes on. Okay, you take the psychedelics, but how is that actually like what's happening afterwards that's actually helping mental health or the mental health that the issues that they're, you know, having, you know, they're trying to face and overcome in their own personal lives?
I think the biggest thing for my patients in the trauma space is going to be new neural networks. If you're coming and you're doing psychedelic or ketamine for depression, then the science behind that is going to be a little bit different. You're going to have more at ease. You're going to have some of those things that your psychiatrist can chat with you about.
Yeah.
For trauma-based psychedelic therapy, I mean, you're still going to benefit from all that stuff, that the depression, like you're going to have more capacity.
Yeah.
The actual dosing session, we're not anxious.
Yeah.
But trauma sets up in our brain these neural pathways. So like I said, we can have this either really scary memory that we're having hypervigilance and flashbacks to, and then we have these truths of it, or we just have these truths because our life just was. Like, we grew up and it just was. And so then we are adults now, we're existing and it just is.
Yeah.
That's chronic trauma, right? And we can even have a hard time being like, where do I start? Or this therapist is never going to be able to understand it, because we won't, because your experience and it's chronic.
Yeah.
So what happened is our brain creates these neural pathways. So I'm hypervigilant because if you move fast, you can hit me.
Mm-hmm.
And so now I'm aware of every room I walk into of who's moving fast, who's jerky, who's jumpy.
Yeah. Right.
Because I have that pathway.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas if you grew up, Stacey, and no one's ever hit you, you're not jumpy. You walk into a room and you're just glowing and shining and you're having a great time.
Right.
And you're not in your head about the safety of the environment.
Yeah.
So ketamine helps us create new neural networks, new pathways.
Yeah.
So the integration, we could be like, what came up for you? Oh, this reminder that I'm so jumpy and I'm always afraid.
Right.
And then we get to explore, when did that stop happening? Who is no longer in our life that did that to us? Where are the spaces that we are actually safe?
Yeah.
Right. And then we can remap that in our brain.
Right.
So people being jumpy can just be people being nervous.
Right.
People being jumpy can be people excited and their friend just showed up and they want to stand up fast. So it creates a new neural map or pathway to people's behavior that people with trauma have a hard time doing by themselves.
Right.
I hope that made sense.
No, it does make sense. It's pretty amazing how that works. You know, it's amazing how, you know, you could open up, you know, pathways in your brain, and you can go back in time and you can figure out certain traumas in your life that occurred, you know, and how they've actually, you know, affected you in your present life, you know, and how it's actually, you know, hurting your future, you know, because everything that happens in our present life has an effect on our future, you know, and people are struggling daily in their, you know, future, in their present moment, you know, it's really hard. And, you know, and then that's when all the other emotions, like we talked, the lack of self-worth or the lack of self-belief and maybe low self-esteem. And then people are, you know, in these moments in life where they just feel stuck, or they just don't feel worthy enough that they can excel to their dreams that they probably had once in their life, you know, and to be able to get over that hump is amazing, because everybody has a dream and every dream can become a reality. And if we have barriers, you know, that are holding us back, we really have to approach them in any way, you know, possible. And like we were talking about earlier, like not every, you know, there's different therapies for different people, and like different therapies can be really effective other than the two that we just spoke of, because it really depends on the person, their personality, what they're comfortable doing, what they're not comfortable doing. You know, everybody reacts differently. So maybe like you can talk about, like, you know, some of the other therapies that could help people with trauma and different, you know, things, like you deal with post-traumatic, you know, stress disorder, you deal with lots of different, you know, mental health issues. Maybe you can mention some of the ones, because the mental health issues that you deal with are really prevalent in our society. And, you know, it just wasn't talked about back in the day, but so many people go through it in our present, you know, life today, and they struggle. And I think too, some people feel embarrassed, you know, or shamed that they have, you know, this disorder, or they think they might have it because they have all the symptoms, you know, but they're afraid to say something, you know, and they're also maybe afraid of being in denial because they just don't want to accept it, you know. So maybe you can talk about some of the other therapies that are really good and what they're good for. And then maybe later on, we could talk about some of these conditions that you deal with on a regular basis and how different ways could help them also progress in their daily lives.
Mm-hmm. I love both of those questions. So the other providers, I think that there are personal kind of view and opinion, if someone enters this space of wanting to help people, I think most of us have really good intentions in doing that. And if you feel particularly drawn to someone who's more spiritually inclined or someone who's more professionally inclined, maybe you're going to start with a coach and mm-hmm. they don't necessarily, they're not going to lean all into the origin. Or if you aren't inclined for the medical model of ketamine. So ketamine mm-hmm. is fantastic. It is legal, but it is absolutely in like the American culture medical model. I am held to expectations and boundaries. So is your prescriber. Like it feels therapy in our like American culture medical model.
Yeah.
Maybe that isn't sitting with you and you want to find a shaman and go into the forest of Peru. I'm jealous of you, but do it. Like, I think that whatever feels naturally pulling you is where you should start. Right. I don't think that there's one person, like I only have capacity to see 30 people a week and I'm at 25. And so I'm not sitting here being like, I'm the one, like the it's, and if any clinician says that, approach them with caution.
Yeah.
Because there's so many amazing people who are doing amazing work, helping yeah. people feel more connected with themselves in right. lots of different communities, and that are going to be most respectful to the part of you that matters the most.
Right.
So as though like you don't get to know my story because it's not my space, but if you yeah. go on my website, you're going to read about me, and then you're going to say this person, the parts of them that matter to me matter to them.
Right.
If you want a clinician who you are like pre-transition and you want a clinician who's transitioned, you're going to yeah. find that. You want a clinician who practices your religion or is at your stage of life. Find that. Yeah. Like I'm not everyone's stage of life cup of tea, and that's okay. So I'd say that for like modalities or where to go, I think there's some great websites. Psychology Today is a fantastic place to start. You can also start at Healing Maps if you're like, I want psychedelic space and I'm not sure what's around me. Healing Maps yeah. is a Google of all retreats and psychedelic clinicians and all of that stuff kind of around. And then I would say my only caveat to that though is if you really think you know what's going on, find a clinician who's niched down and specialized in that.
Right.
So in kind of the transition into that second question, I work with people with PTSD or complex PTSD who have disassociation or dysregulation or an inability to feel fully connected to all the parts of themselves or the people that they want to connect with.
Yeah.
A lot of times, and it's just kind of naturally happened, and I think it's because of my professional career before Pothos, it's yeah. typically high-level execs or entrepreneurs who are like, I can do this business thing. I'm killing it over here. And I've got it all my ducks in a row. And then here's this personal part that just the rules don't apply.
Yeah.
The thing about trauma is we create safety rules. That's why like the hypervigilance example.
Yeah.
Professional rules, you will excel if you are a rule-based person.
Yeah.
Have people follow the rules. Your kids aren't going to do that. Your spouse isn't going to do that. Your mother-in-law is not here for it. So then this part, it just doesn't. And then you're like, how could something work so well here and be a complete blank show over here?
Right.
And then confused. And so that's coming from that potential like chronic trauma space. And I would say first or second session, no one comes to me and they're like, I have trauma. They're usually yeah. just like, why is that happening? And they want the answer and thinking that it's just going to be like a kind of come and go thing.
Right.
And so I'd say that that's where I specialize in. And in doing that, it means I don't specialize in OCD or obsessive compulsive disorder. I don't specialize in eating disorders. I don't work with children. I have a team and some of my amazing clinicians do, and they deserve all of the credit in the world. I don't. And if you think you know what's going on, read the clinician kind of profile, really be like, I think this is what's going on, and find a clinician who is niched in it, who's willing to say no to other things because they're really passionate about this thing
right.
or that particular population. If you're like, I don't know what I have, but I know yeah. this identify, this is who I am as a person, like postpartum moms, there's so many clinicians who've like niche. So that's just like your identity.
Yeah.
And so go ahead and get that level of help.
Right.
I think amazing generalists out there who kind of like work with anyone and everyone.
Yeah.
If you know what's going on, start with the specialist, someone who's taken the extra trainings and is passionate about what they're doing and why they're doing it.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah, I agree 100% with you. I think what you're doing is so good because I like I mentioned earlier, there's so many different, medical issues that people, and because people are always afraid for the longest time to admit that they have, that they have a mental health disorder. They were afraid to say I'm bipolar or I have depression or, I have post-traumatic stress disorder. It made them feel stigmatized or labelized because we do live in a society that is stigmatized and labelized for whatever reason, even though everybody has something, people like to place judgment on others, I guess it's the easy way out. I found that it's easier to look at somebody else and pick out their flaws instead of just looking at themselves and saying, you know what, I have certain issues that can make me a better person if I address them, and not worry about everybody around them. It's a great, way to, mask the problem and not have to deal with it. But, if you're open to really, deep down in your heart that you have issues, you may not, like you said, most people don't know what they are, but they know they're having issues and it's holding them back. If they're willing to like take that next step and talk to someone who's a professional and then, decide on the different therapies that are the best options and then work together to get to that common goal that, that patient wants and that you want for the patient, someone can excel to such high levels in their life, but like we said, it takes time. It takes effort and you have to be willing to do the work because you can't, I've noticed a lot when I've talked to people and even, I've done a lot of advocate work for a lot of people and, people just want to take a magic pill or they want, they want this easy way to do it. And they expect quick results, one, two, three. And it's not like that in any case, either a mental disorder, or you have a physical disorder, whatever the problem may be. If you're coping with something, you're trying to get over it, especially a mental health issue, and trauma is involved. It's going to take time. It's going to take time because each part that holds to your heart and causes you a lot of negative emotions, you're going to have to address each and every one of them with your therapist and figure out ways to overcome them, and it's a gradual process, but, and it also involves pain and healing. But once you get over, like I mentioned earlier, I'll repeat it again. Once you get over that hump, it's like a brand new life and, people could live and be happy. And that's what we want for people. We want people to live and be happy and know how to control their emotions. And, you focus on, post-traumatic stress disorder. I've known people that have overcome that and now they can communicate better with others. They don't blow up at them and they don't, and they don't go back to the past and they don't, dwell on the things that, caused them, the problems in the first place. And I find many military officers that come back, from being on tours, develop, post-traumatic stress disorder, but it doesn't always have to be military. People could have things in their lives that just cause them, emotional stress, and it just causes them to develop post-traumatic stress disorder, and it's okay. That's what people have to realize, that it's okay. And if you had to take everything that we talked about today and you really want to, summarize it and give some good points for people to, what would you like to emphasize and have people understand?
Well, first, I loved everything you just said. Yes, it's absolutely okay. And there is unfortunately so much stigma. And I think maybe answering your question and looping in, if everyone knew that they really mattered, like, and your brain and your mind matters and your mental health matters just as much as your physical, and you matter, and your wants, needs, and desires matter, not more than everyone else's, but just as much as everyone else's.
Yeah.
That really landed, and we were comfortable and confident kind of sharing with the people that we cared about and that care about us with what we need. Then that's how in kind of my perspective, we can show up and be ourselves in any place. And we really deeply understand that wherever we were taught that we didn't matter, we could go back there and like give that version of us a really big hug and tell them that.
Right.
And it can stop some of that stigma, that bias. Right. And we can also show up as ourselves, because that's the goal of therapy. It's not for you to be like anyone else. It's for you to be more and more like yourself.
Yeah, exactly. And that's a great point. You know, you want to be you, because sometimes, you know, I see people and they're living the life that other people want them to live. And they never get to live the life they really want it to. They're always like, you know, like you mentioned, people pleasers. They're always doing for everybody else. But if you took all their titles away, if you took, let's say, you know, if they, you know, they, let's say they were an entrepreneur or a mom, or, you know, and you took all their titles away, you know, and then they were left with no titles, you know, and you ask them, who are you? What's your purpose? And they just look at you and they don't know, you know, because their whole life they've been living to please others, but they never took the time to give themselves a little self-love and to really think about, what do they want? And never gave themselves the time to be the person they want to be.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yeah. And so I think that's the takeaway. Let's start asking ourselves, what do we want, with this deep understanding that we matter? And if that's hard, find a great therapist, because there's so many.
And what you have a newsletter, and you were telling me that in your newsletter you have different coping skills that you provide people who sign up. Where can people find your website, and where can people sign up for your newsletter?
So website is Pothos Health. Pothos like the plant, P-O-T-H-O-S. And you can find me on Therapy with Kayla on Instagram, and that'll link you to everything that I've got going on and all of my educational stuff. I really put a lot of emphasis into educating because of the stigma that you were talking about. I really want people to just feel seen and heard in that space. And my website will also link you to the newsletter, but you can find it either on my Insta or my website. And I work with people in Oklahoma, Texas, and Florida. So if someone wants to work with me personally, that's where I'm licensed.
Oh, wonderful. So if they're out of state and they're not in Dallas area, they could have sessions with you over Zoom then.
It looks just like this.
And they can find that information on your website also?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Oh, wonderful. My gosh, this has been amazing. Now, before we go, is there anything else you'd like to touch base on, or anything that you'd like to really, you know, share with our listeners before we go?
I think it's enjoyable. I really do. And I hope that if the information doesn't personally apply to you, that you can share it with someone that you think that does, because PTSD and complex PTSD are really hard things to live with. I hope that it lands with you. And then if it doesn't, you feel comfortable sharing it with someone else and they can get some resources and some help.
Oh, 100%, 100%. And there are people, I've known people that have had it and they didn't know for years. They didn't realize until people started to address it and started to tell them. And, you know, because it, I find, you know, I just want to say, when you live in an environment and you have this post-traumatic stress disorder, sometimes it becomes so natural that you don't really realize that your behavior is not, you know, the way it should be, you know, and sometimes you don't even realize that you're hurting others around you, you know, until someone actually has the courage to say, hey, you know, you're hurting me, or hey, you know, what you're doing is not right to that person, or, you know, you shouldn't have these outbursts, and you shouldn't be fearful of this or that, you know. Like, I, you know, before we go, I just want to mention, like, I used to write for a veterans magazine, and I remember this guy saying that when he came home from his tours, that if he heard the littlest sound, he used to jump out of bed and get into the stanza that he learned in the military, like a gun stanza, you know, how to protect yourself, you know, there was a certain stand that they had to do. And he used to go like almost hide under his bed in the stands. And it would just be like natural, because it was, you know, it was a either, you know, live or die moment when he was doing these tours, and it carried over when he transitioned to the, into the, you know, real world, I'll say, the, you know, regular society. And it was very hard for him to get out of that. So, you know, there are a lot of people that have it, and you don't, like I said, you don't have to be in the military. You could have just something traumatic in your life occur, whether it's at childhood age or, you know, into adulthood. But, you know, if you notice these symptoms and you notice that you're not acting right, and you notice that you may be hurting other people, maybe, you know, people should take a step back and try to be honest with themselves, you know, and just really think about, hey, you know, other people look like they're getting hurt or they feel upset from what I said. Maybe I should, you know, maybe I should talk to someone and see if this is normal. You know, am I, you know, what's going on? You know, because I think it's so important. I think post-traumatic stress disorder, so many, it's become so prevalent in society because it never was diagnosed before. And that was the problem. So many people had it. It just wasn't diagnosed. And now it's coming to light and people are realizing it. And I'm so glad there are people like you, Kayla, that can be out there and give them different, you know, therapy techniques to help them. So I just say, I give kudos to you and everything you're doing. And I thank you for being on the show today and sharing all this wonderful knowledge with us.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. And thank you for creating this space for people to come together and share their knowledge. I really appreciate it. I really appreciate your time.
I appreciate that. Thank you so much. And well, you have a great day, and I hope, you know, maybe we could see you in the future because you're just a wonderful person. And I'd love to know more about, you know, all these different, you know, ways of therapy and how people can help themselves so people can learn and use it, you know, in their own lives and learn how to apply it in their lives. So thank you so much for coming on the show.
You're welcome.
Have a good day.
You too.